But what we have the opportunity to do over the next hour is delve into the actual experience of heading up an absolutely iconic, world-class university. And I have to say, a very tricky and difficult time in that university's history. So I'm absolutely delighted to have Nick Dirks with me for the next hour. Thanks for being here, Nick. It was this time last year, of course, that we were in Berkeley itself, and an awful lot has happened even since then involving you and the university, not least that tweet from Donald Trump, threatening to defund Berkeley, which I'm sure we'll get onto in due course. I suppose when I sat down and thought about how we might frame the discussion, it occurred to me that Nick, you've probably had one of the toughest jobs in global higher education over the last few years. You might say one of the best jobs too, I don't know. You might not, we should find out. But it's undeniable that the incredible strength and iconic status of the University of California, Berkeley, has come with some extraordinary challenges. You were Chancellor there for 4 years, I think, from 2013 until June this year. So great to have you with us. Maybe I'll start by, before we sort of look back at the last 4 years and the challenges you faced, with particular reference to governance, since that's the topic of the title, I'll ask you, is it the toughest job in global higher education?
I'll defer to John Hennessy, former president of Stanford, and Drew Faust, current, although soon to be former president of Harvard, both of whom said Berkeley is certainly the hardest job in higher education in the U.S. So I hope by citing them I don't sound defensive. It is, of course, one of the greatest universities in the U.S. and the world, and even though we slipped a little bit in the rankings, in the reputational rankings, we're still in the top six. Some of the slippage has to do with funding and some of the issues that I've been dealing with over the past few years. So I don't think it's really about the diminished quality, but it is about the challenges both of the present and of the future. I would have said, I think, some years ago that it probably was the best job in higher education because it both was taking responsibility for really one of the most, in terms of academic quality, excellence in research and so on, one of the very best leading rankings aside, universities anywhere in the world. But I think the issues that we're calling attention to by saying we're going to be talking at least a bit about governance, do allow me to say that it's become less possible to do the job in the ways in which I at least felt I needed to do it in order to best support the kind of mission that we had, not only in research, but also in, and this is where I often feel most proud when I talk about Berkeley, in the kind of way in which we serve a public mission. Unlike Harvard, which has still been struggling to increase the number and percentage of low-income students, for example, we have a third of our students who come on Pell Grants, which means that they come from families making less than $45,000. We have students who are undocumented, many of whom, of course, are waiting for the announcement by Trump or by the Attorney General next hour as to that. But we have students who were formerly incarcerated. We have students who come back to college after many years. Carol Fult talked about that at the University of North Carolina as well. And we have students who literally never dreamed that they could come to one of the finest places in the world and study with Nobel laureates and the like. And that combination is what compelled me to move west from Columbia, from New York, and I'm an East Coaster, so even though California is always twinned with the term dream, I was actually quite happy in Big Apple. But it's also that combination that has, and again this came up in the first panel this morning, made life under the current regime of governance more and more challenging, I think, over the past few chancellorships, not just mine.
Mm. I read that you have something like 9,000 students on Pell Grants.
That's right.
Which, in terms of volume, is actually almost as many as all eight Ivy League institutions put together.
Correct.
That gives you an extraordinary profile as a world-leading research university too, in terms of a student body, and results in this idea of what I've seen termed as sort of insurgent citizenship amongst the students, which I know has become or has played a very important role in the period that you've been there, that some of the sort of difficulties that you face, but that must be a strength as well as a potential weakness, having that incredible energised, engaged buy-in from the student body.
When I was being interviewed for the job, it should have struck me more powerfully than perhaps it did, that about half of the interview was spent talking about my experience of working with student protest. of course, I was a child in the 60s, and so I just recently moved out of the chancellor's house into our own house a couple miles away from campus, and going through boxes and papers that I hadn't gone through for years and years, I found a copy of the local newspaper in central Connecticut with a picture of me and some of my compatriots in the president's office at Wesleyan University. In a takeover protest that I was very, very proud of. So I felt that I came to Berkeley with both the pedigree and, of course, through Columbia as well, which has a somewhat restive history, certainly.
But have you ever thrown any petrol bombs?
Not violence. That's all the way. But to your point, the engagement of students, and for that matter faculty, is something that that drew me to Berkeley, and it was something that I continued to feel was something that, you know, my colleagues were often very envious of, until it turned out that some protests were taken over by a number of groups who basically felt that it was their job to constantly delegitimize the administration. And so all the efforts at dialogue, all the efforts at engagement got put under a kind of cloud by virtue of really staged confrontations that I felt made it very, very difficult to maintain the kind of relationships to the most active and vocal students in the student body. So it was both a strength, and I worry though that it's going to be a difficult challenge going forward, especially with the heightened level of not only activism on campus, but the focus of many activist groups on college campuses and on Berkeley in particular.
Mm. I'd like to come back to this. Before we do, maybe, because now's probably the time to do it, if we go back to you joining in Berkeley in 2013, perhaps you could just give us a bit of a flavour of the situation, the particularly the funding situation when you came into Berkeley and the job that you thought you were taking up, and perhaps what the reality was when you actually found yourself in office.
I was offered and accepted the job in the fall of 2012, and I actually accepted the job the day after the U.S. election, which was also the day there was a referendum in California. Proposition 30, which was about funding for education, including higher education, and it passed. It passed in large part because of the active mobilization of students across the University of California system and the state, and it promised at least what I thought would be a far better financial situation, corresponding to what had taken place in California in its state-level economy. Which had rebounded and was for the first time in many years looking at a surplus going forward. Last time the state had a surplus, Arnold Schwarzenegger was the governor. He promised that he would increase funding to the university, and then, of course, things turned south in the economy, and that never came to pass. But it turned out that the funding situation was, in fact, much more fragile. And not, in fact, something that was fixed by any means by the passage of Proposition 30. When my predecessor, Bob Birgeneau, who had been the president of the University of Toronto before he went to Berkeley, took office in 2004, 34% of the university budget came from the state. Mm. I took office, it was 12%. Everyone thought that we would rebound. The economy had rebounded, so therefore state funding should as well. In fact, today it's 11%. And despite various deals that have been worked out over the years, there's just a steady diminution of funding from the state and a growing reliance on other kinds of resources, revenue streams, and...
Have you been able to replace the funding that's been lost from the state, have you, or has the overall size of the overlay come down in that time?
Well, the budget is larger, but the deficit is very large too. When I did take office, things were okay. There had been massive increases in tuition, which of course had occasioned a great deal of pushback on the part of students and others in the years following the Great Recession. So in 2010, 2011, tuition went up almost by 35%. In 2012, in reaction to the spike in tuition rates, a freeze was called. And that freeze was a natural reaction, I think, to raising tuition so dramatically. The other thing that happened at Berkeley in particular was that we increased, or my predecessor increased, the number of out-of-state students, by which I mean both students from Nevada and students from the Netherlands. So it's about 11% international now, about 12% out-of-state. But they pay it at a higher tuition. And that, in the short term, meant that the finances were okay. But with the tuition freeze that ensued after 2012, and then with a cap that was imposed on out-of-state students, that revenue stream just held constant. State funding held constant, but the expenses kept going up.
Those two taps that potentially could be turned on or off, from a funding point of view, what control did you have over them as Chancellor, and to what extent were you reliant on the office of the President or indeed the Governor?
We were entirely reliant. It was a new situation for me, coming from a private institution where, in fact, it was my job as the Executive Vice President to set the tuition rate for the college. I had to get approval from the Board of Trustees, but that was the process. Here, it had to be approved by the Regents, who were advised by the President, but who was also in negotiation with the Governor. And although we made clear our need for greater revenue, whether it would come from the state, whether it would come from tuition, in fact, we didn't get it, and at my level, I had almost no control over it at all.
So you came into office, and one of the things that you did fairly early on, I believe, in your tenure, was to set up this Office for Strategic Initiatives, which presumably was looking at the budget and how you could balance the books. I don't know if you want to just explain that process a little bit.
As anyone knows who ever did it, strategic plans are very difficult, because, of course, once you begin them, you realize that constituency is deeply concerned with trying to see how they can work that process to maximize, of course, their own advantages and so on. So what I felt we needed was a structure that would produce maximum participation on the part of a lot of different constituencies, but that would also make very clear that decisions would have to be made, that choices would have to, at some point, involve cuts to some units, possible mergers of other units, and decisions that could also lead to investments in some areas that would be substantially more than investments in others. So we did set up the structure, and it turned out to be, at the beginning, something that was seen as just being fine, but once faculty and others became aware of the scale of the deficit, the idea of the office became a target of a great deal of criticism on campus, and so we ultimately shut it down.
So Berkeley has a very unique, particularly the engaged students I talked about, but the incredibly engaged faculty as well, your retention rate, the extent to which people start off as early career researchers at Berkeley and stay on the tenure track all the way through and buy into the institution as this great iconic public. Again, great strength in one regard, but you have this very engaged academic senate, don't you? So was that a real, you know, I'm thinking, starting to think about the governance structures here. You have a very potentially challenging governance from above, from the governor and indeed the office of the president, but you also have this very engaged governance structure within the institution. So that must have been a challenge for you, having faculty that when they realized potentially budget cuts had to be made, were able to interfere in that.
It emerged like All Good Things in a Faculty Revolt that took place in 1919. It turns out that it was the first real academic senate in the U.S., but within about 3 or 4 years, many universities had faculty senates that were given greater roles in university governance. The period of the late 19th, early 20th century was the period in the U.S. of the great leader. In the case of University of California, it was Benjamin Ida Wheeler. He used to, and this is true, I've seen the photographs and so on, ride around campus on a white horse with a big stick, accosting students who he saw if they weren't in class, asking, you know, whether they were actually going to class or not, and who made all decisions about hiring faculty, about you know, keeping them on and promoting them and so on. So the faculty had a revolt, and the Senate was set up, and it's actually a kind of remarkable structure of and an exemplary structure of faculty participation. I even used it as a model when at Columbia I tried to develop a new form of faculty governance that would be more robust, since it wasn't really in a very healthy state at Columbia. But a couple of things I'd say. One, that it was it really developed all of its protocols and even its culture at a time of very generous state funding. And so, for example, there was in the Academic Senate, there is in the Academic Senate, a committee called the Budget Committee. It is anything but a budget committee. It makes every recommendation about faculty salaries. It makes every recommendation about faculty promotion and tenure. Every retention offer has to go through the budget committee. It is really where key academic decisions, academic personnel decisions, are made. And if I, as the chancellor or the provost, disagree with the recommendation of that committee, we have to actually go sit before them in person, explain the reasons for our disagreement, and in effect get their dispensation to take their advice and not follow it. So you don't do it very often.
Mm-hmm.
And it works very well because the faculty really do feel that they're in control of a lot of really critical decisions. But they're called the budget committee, and in fact they don't work to a budget. All of these decisions are made on the basis of a notional sense of quality, justice, fair play across the institution without a single dollar figure aside from each salary amount being put into a spreadsheet to add up to anything. So the difficulty that when you have a major financial struggle, crisis even, as we have had and continue to have, is that there's no body in the Senate that actually thinks about financial trade-offs. And so that is one problem. The second problem is that the Senate has legitimacy among some faculty, but Berkeley, being Berkeley, has a number of different faculty organizations, one of which in particular, the Berkeley Faculty Association, is very powerful. It has about 250 members on the faculty out of a total faculty of 1,500. And they see themselves as a rump group that is not represented by the Senate, and have a direct line to the local media, and prosecute their own concerns either against the Senate or against the administration, often by simply working as if they're a parallel faculty government.
The media you mentioned there was another.
The mendacious media.
The mendacious media we heard about yesterday, who bit back with a vengeance in today's newspapers.
I didn't say it, I'm just quoting
for the record. Clearly you had a pretty rough ride yourself with the media and the local media in California, sort of taking a very scrutinizing very carefully every detail of what was going on at Berkeley. I wonder if you have any reflections on the extent to which the media play a direct role in the decisions that are being made within the university governance structures, whether it's, you know, at the governor level or indeed at the level of the chancellor. Is it the case, as we imagine, that pressure really, you know, gets into the process and changes the decisions that are made?
Regents of the University of California, there are 24 regents. The president of the regents is the governor. There's a wonderful separation in terms of governance so that the state legislature and the government and the governor do not actually make direct decisions about university policy, but they fund the university and through their funding can exert obviously a great deal of pressure. But the regents are appointed by governors. They have very long terms, and that's supposed to insulate them from any particular political position, but they're political appointees. And so when a story comes out of the newspaper, they read the story, they think about what it means for them, and react accordingly. And often that is about managing their own sense of their reputation and association with the university. And so, for example, the subject du jour, salaries. On the one hand, in closed session, the regents are concerned about being competitive. They know that the salaries of chancellors and many of the top positions, certainly in the medical schools, but also vice chancellors for administration and finance, for example, are much lower than in the private university world. And indeed, when there's a job at any of those levels, a lot of really qualified people simply don't make themselves available to the interview because they just say, I can't go to California and make that kind of money and so on and so forth, and I can get twice as much if I go to California, I go to Stanford or USC or Caltech. But again, to your point, the way in which the governance system at the level of the university takes place, I mean, the University of California system, is one that is incredibly responsive to media-driven kinds of issues. Mm. And so one also feels that in regents' meetings, regents are making comments that they know are going to be picked up by the press and therefore have to speak accordingly. Mm. On the one hand, one of the great things about public universities is a sense of public accountability. And we are incredibly transparent in terms of releasing financial information. You know, virtually any document except for personnel decisions can be scrutinized by the public. But on the other hand, what it does is put us at a comparative disadvantage to private universities that simply don't do not operate under that constraint. So the California Public Record Act, the Freedom of Information Act, none of those apply to private universities. Yeah. And so for some reason, there's never an article about the salary of the president of Stanford or what have you. These simply don't, I say that only because it's been in the news here. What's really to the point is that almost every decision you make, and in my case, it felt like everything I did was part of a public examination. And I was there, in some sense, in my role as chancellor, to be the foil for concerns about things that had nothing to do with me per se, but had to do with worries about the cost of higher education, worries about students who applied and then didn't get into the university, especially to Berkeley, so that the issues around out-of-state enrollment, international enrollment, higher standards for admission.
Was there a particular moment when that experience of being a lightning rod for other things, you know, really crystallized? Is there an example that you think really kind of would demonstrate the kind of absurdity, perhaps, of some of
There was a story that I had built an escape hatch. And it was the most tweeted story about University of California, Berkeley during the summer of 2016. Now, when the report came out, I actually didn't know what they were talking about at all. So I went to my office and I started looking for the escape hatch. And I thought that it was a door that was being built at the request of the staff in the office. We had a number of occupations, and some of the occupations had felt very threatening to the staff. And so they'd begun to look at how they could potentially build a door that would allow a separate exit for staff on the occasion of an office occupation. This door was labeled as an escape hatch for me, and the meme started. So I mean, I was in the office. My hair was straight up, my mustache, my glasses, and me on a slide going through, you know, some kind of Disneyland-like Matterhorn ride to get to the safety of wherever outside of my office. And I thought, okay, surely the record will be corrected when, you know, when some follow-up was done. And it's still, it's out there. Yeah. And virtually, I mean, I don't Google myself, but the escape hatches is indelibly associated with me for the rest of my life.
The obvious issues behind all this is that you're essentially describing a university that still has all the scrutiny and expectations and ethos of a public university with everything that goes with that, but essentially has been privatised in terms of its funding structure. And you know, I think you were sort of personally accused of privatising Berkeley. Could you just explain how that played out?
Always something that struck me as odd, because I felt that, in fact, it had been the state that had begun to privatise the University of California when it cut its funding so dramatically. And of course, you know, doesn't matter what the percentage is that comes in from the state, you still have to pay the bills. And so, of course, the university was focused on fundraising. One of the reasons I was hired from a private institution on the East Coast is that I was being brought in to help revamp the way in which the university was doing fundraising. There were faculty who felt that fundraising was inherently corrupt, that to have private donors give major gifts to universities meant that they were driving the priorities of the university and were getting thereby an outsized role in thinking about academic priorities. So the sense was, we really want to go back to a day when the state gave us money and the state didn't have nefarious priorities, and that would keep the university pure. So public pure, private impure became the, you know, the kind of paired opposites of a discourse around funding that nevertheless struck me as being totally unreal. Not only did we need to revamp our fundraising apparatus, we needed to think about partnerships, public-private partnerships, we needed to think about even commercializing our brand, which we did in a big deal that we made with Under Armour for our athletic programs, all things that I was, of course, trained in very deeply at Columbia, where you have to pay the television to put on a football game, as opposed to, you know, big time Pac-12 sports. But that debate continues, and again, even when a university has a third of its funding from the state, a lot of its core operations, in fact, do get paid for by the government. But when you're down to 11%, it's simply not the case. And so what I thought would be a necessary, if difficult, dialogue around, debate around what it means to maintain a public mission with increased private funding, often devolved into these oppositions, which made private funding seem incompatible with a public institution. Now, at its best, I would say that in some ways, Berkeley's public mission has never been greater than when it's actually had to rely more on private funding. And I say that because, for example, if you look back at the student demographics in 1960, it was overwhelmingly white middle class. And now whites are a minority across the university. Socioeconomic distribution is very different than it was. It wasn't always like that, even if you didn't have Pell Grant grants to mark the differences as graphically as you can do today. And so, you know, it was my view, and certainly the view of others in the administration, that you could use private funding and still have a very, very clear commitment to being a public university and all that that stood for, both historically, but also looking forward in terms of the needs of California and the needs, for that matter, of the nation and the world.
Well, we've talked a lot about the regional local responsibilities of a public university like Berkeley. But you're also, of course, Berkeley was a truly world-class university, as you say, sort of top 10 in terms of reputation, even if it's slipping a little bit in the world rankings that have just been unveiled. But how do you think that, that's a viable, sustainable sort of duality, if you like, to be on the one hand grappling with these incredibly difficult local funding issues, also trying to fulfil your responsibilities as a public university in California, and also on the other hand be world class, you know, attract researchers who are producing absolutely world class research? What's the sort of the future, do you think, for Berkeley in that regard?
The truth is, when you have the kind of faculty, the caliber of faculty across so many different departments and schools and colleges and units and so on as we have at Berkeley, the institution maintains a very high level of quality just by virtue of the desire of the best young PhDs to work with them, to be associated with them, to come to a place that's been known for being top in their field. And so, you know, to a very large extent, if you actually look at the numbers so far anyway, we're doing as well as we've ever done in terms of recruiting junior faculty and in terms of retaining faculty when they get outside office. What we have, however, also found is that there are more outside offers. They're more difficult to meet and maintain certain kinds of commitment to parity, at least relative parity across salary scales. And that it's much more difficult to recruit mid-level and senior faculty than it was even 10 years ago. Mm.
Let me ask you about free speech. This is clearly another of the absolute touchstone topics in higher education in several countries, but particularly in the US over the last year or two. And Berkeley's clearly had some very high profile cases of controversial speakers, right-wing speakers, some of whom might be best described as trolls, who nevertheless were due to speak at Berkeley, and there have been protests in the case of Milo Yiannopoulos, a particularly high-profile case where the talk had to be called off, and you woke up, no doubt, to
a Cambridge dropout too.
Yeah. But you must have woken that morning to the slightly extraordinary feeling of a Donald Trump tweet directed at you, sort of.
Yeah, I was the first university leader to get a tweet from Trump.
Before we get into the issue, describe what that felt like. Did you wake up and look at your smartphone and see it waiting for you?
Was sent it at around 5:30 in the morning. Look, that night, the night before the tweet, to go back to Milo, was a deeply, deeply troubling evening. Nobody really believed that that Milo's coming to campus was a test of free speech, in the sense in which we normally think about speech acts, controversy, debate on university campuses. Yiannopoulos had established, I mean, he was, as most of you know, he was thrown off Twitter. You have to be really egregious to get thrown off Twitter, as we have discovered. But, you know, he was invited by the Berkeley College Republicans. They are a bona fide group, and for many reasons felt that they had been picked on, that they had themselves suffered a lot of the things that would have been proscribed for other groups on campus, or with respect to other groups on campus. And so we went out of our way to think about security plans, and we brought in police from other UC campuses, and thought we had a plan to allow him to speak, to control protest groups, to keep them apart from each other, and to have an event that would not be used by the media and by Yiannopoulos' people. And of course, he was at Breitbart at the time, to cast any kind of doubt on our commitment to free speech. And, Berkeley, home of free speech, is also a public university, and it's important to just note, for those of you who don't know, I think most of you do, but in the U.S., the First Amendment does not apply to private institutions. It only applies to public institutions. It's government property. So we don't have a choice about whether or not we allow speakers to come if they've been invited according to a set of protocols that need to be consistent across any political group or body. But, you know, as I think most people around the world discovered, there was saw on, you know, CNN or wherever, a group of Antifa came to campus, and they came with the intent purpose of shutting it down. We had no idea they were coming. They were able to mobilize without any trace on social media. And about 150 individuals dressed in black with masks, using black bloc tactics, came up Bancroft Avenue, set a fire to distract attention away from the event, moved to the event, marched in, immediately dispersed across the crowd so that they were sort of protected, as it were, by the other students and some other protesters who were there. And then proceeded to fire M80s and fairly good-sized fireworks at the building, and then ultimately take the barricades, use them to smash open the windows, and cause the police on the spot to say, we cannot guarantee the safety of people on the plaza. We can't guarantee the safety of Milo Yiannopoulos himself, and escorted him to his car and got him off campus, and thus canceled the event. So. It was a really difficult evening. We'd never seen anything like it before. Now, of course, we not only have seen it again, but we think when it might be coming. But we also, and this was the most difficult thing, I think, speaking from the point of view of somebody in Berkeley, realized that the violence had been enacted by people who claimed to be on the left. Now, the political character of the Antifa is something that's being much debated in the U.S. right now. Recently, the mayor of Berkeley, an old student radical from, not actually old, a young student radical from Berkeley, youngest elected mayor of Berkeley ever, came out and called them the street gang. But it was not the right that caused the problems. And many students sympathized with them and thought that that was indeed an appropriate thing to do, to make sure the event couldn't take place, to make sure these hateful statements couldn't be made on campus.
Mm-hmm.
So waking up the next morning already feeling as if there had been a kind of escalation both of violence and of activism, and a serious challenge to our own capacity to actually match our rhetoric on free speech with the reality. To find the tweet threatening the cessation of federal funds was not a good way to wake up.
No, I can imagine. And certainly Trump is a particularly obvious example of it, is the politicization of Berkeley's affairs. And I know you've written in the Washington Post about your concern about the broader creeping attempts to exert political control over universities, and perhaps you could tell us a little bit about some of the legislation that's cropping up. I think you said 14 states that now have legislation coming through to try and exert some control over freedom of speech, potentially impinging on autonomy and so on.
It's a very curious phenomenon because, free speech back in the 60s and most of its career has been a right that's been strongly advocated for by people on the left, and now increasingly it's people on the right who are concerned. Although there are people who are elusive in terms of political categorization, the group called FIRE that is run by Greg Lukianoff, the fellow who was at Yale when a shouting match took place in one of the colleges and captured it on video. But there are a number of institutes, among them the Goldwater Institute, that has been advocating for free speech for a long time on campuses, largely out of an interest in making sure that conservative voices could be heard and represented on campuses. But they drafted a template for legislation, and it's been taken almost verbatim now in 14 states. Some have passed it, North Carolina, Tennessee, Virginia, Colorado have passed it. Other states are debating it. Wisconsin, California, Kentucky, among others. And it sounds on first reading to be just fine, because it says public universities should be open to speakers, no matter what their political position, and this is something that will be reinforced by this legislation. But then if you read on, it has a number of things that are quite disturbing, one of them being an actual protocol for the disciplining of students who disrupt events through protest. It doesn't define what disruption is, it doesn't define what protest is, but it does define what the punishment should be, which is that two strikes and you're out, and get suspended from the university. So it's taking over the university's right to establish how to deal with student concerns and issues. And there also are statements in the legislation that could be construed to suggest that administrators, including chancellors and presidents, would be judged on the basis of how neutral their statements might be, and could be seen to be in violation of the legislation if they make a comment that looks like they're taking a political side. Again, who's going to adjudicate that, what a political side means? Virtually everything we say around inclusion, equity, and diversity on campus could be seen by some groups as politically inflected, and therefore a potential violation of this legislation. So, in effect, it's a kind of move by various means to use the issue around free speech to take back some of the control that certain groups feel has inappropriately been taken over by the university.
I had a mini Berkeley experience when I was in fourth grade. My father, who was a chemistry professor at St. Olaf College in Minnesota, did a sabbatical at Berkeley. An experience I likened to the move from Lake Wobegon to Sodom and Gomorrah.
Cultural. That's a little extreme.
It is an extreme statement. But the diversity at Berkeley as a child was palpable and exciting. And the heterogeneity was clear. Across the street, the gentleman was a janitor. Next door was a salesman. The block behind us, my brother, who was in third grade, bought a Playmate home. His father was Edwin McMillan, who won a Nobel for discovery of plutonium, and all the kids were playing together. But the question I have is, years later, as a faculty member at Johns Hopkins, I had a wonderful MD, PhD student from Los Angeles. His father was a Japanese immigrant, mother was a Chinese immigrant. And David told me that growing up middle to lower middle class Asian in California, Berkeley was heaven. There was no chance of Stanford. Family had no money. But there was an unwritten rule that they perceived. No more than 41% of UC Berkeley students could be from Asian backgrounds. And the explanation is because 18% will be Black, Hispanic, and the university did not want to have a majority non-white group. And now, of course, this has boiled to the top with lawsuits. The negative selection factor for being Asian in America. Is there something you'd like to comment?
You know, we're not actually getting sued. That would be Harvard and who else is there? And UNC, most recently, that's right. But there, you know, there's a fairly clear concern at the constant level of the percentage of Asian Americans in some institutions. There's greater concern about the Ivy League than there is about the University of California, which has, if not triple, double the percentages of Asian American applicants. But you know, again, the questions around affirmative action in public universities are different than private universities. 1996 in California, Proposition 209 legislated an end to any affirmative action on the basis of race or ethnic community. And so what the university did at that point was to resort to what we call, anyway, holistic admission. So we take a whole lot of factors into account. We just don't use test scores and grades. I think that's appropriate. I think test scores have all kinds of implicit bias that are part of their construction, and studies have shown that. Grades are, even if they're meaningful in a particular context, they're very hard to understand across different contexts, different schools. And in any case, numbers alone are not especially good at predicting how well students will do and what kind of contribution they'll make to the university. But obviously, there are issues and concerns that have been generated around now questions of Asian American admission that are going to be prosecuted on the courts. And I worry again that what might seem, you know, for example, on the basis of the Duke student who didn't get into Harvard and Yale and other Ivy League schools and was one of the parties to one of these suits, and he was covered in the New York Times in a piece about 2 weeks ago, it might seem, you know, self-evident that he has a grievance. The moment you start putting questions that have to do with very complicated decisions that are often necessarily confidential into a public political process, you put yourself on a very slippery slope.
Yeah. We have two questions to the front.
I was wondering about your strategy process and the lack of engagement from your faculty or the lack of cooperation. These are intelligent people, really bright people. How come they didn't understand? Where was it that the understanding of the total situation of the university was just not there?
Say that they didn't understand that there was a need for a strategic planning process of some kind, but you know, very shortly after we set up this office, we also announced what the scale of the deficit was, and it's huge. It was $150 million. Fortunately, we had the money in reserves, but we didn't have it forever, and the projections we were making was that it was going to continue to climb. This was because not only of reasons having to do with a frozen tuition level and capped out-of-state students, it had to do with different ways of distributing monies from the state by the system. Berkeley always was favored in the past, and then, it was equalized across the campus. There were needs for employer as well as employee contributions to the great benefit pool that it was part of the attraction of the University of California. There were lots of things that led to a deficit. But the level of the deficit, the scale of the deficit, frightened faculty and made them think that this process was potentially going to lead to the demise of their own school or their own department. And there's also, and I'll say this now in a way that I perhaps couldn't have said 3 months ago, but there's a lot of inherited distrust of the administration. And doubtless I played into that because I tried to be as open as possible, but you know, in a campus that big, you don't talk to everybody. But also previous administrations had set up different kinds of similar structures to try to save administrative dollars and the like, and many of them had not come out very well, not worked very well. You know, one of the kinds of things that I think is critical to governance regimes is that they can help either foster a better and greater level of trust, or they can work to actually erode it. And my concern about the kind of positioning of university leadership between a governance regime on top that doesn't really include it and a governance regime below that that is at the very least, not always does not always see itself in partnership with the administration, has led to a kind of cultural standoff that that makes understanding seem to be capitulation to administrative fiats and programs and plans that don't really take the brilliance of Berkeley's faculty into full account.
It was by your third year, Nick, you found yourself in an increasingly small space between an unsupportive governor, an active UC system president, and an engaged and sometimes enraged faculty. So I can see why you needed an escape hatch.
If only I had one.
We have time for one more question down here. From
thank you. Frank Reprivo from the University of Luxembourg. Nicolas, you said that the funding from the state dropped up to 11% in the recent years. In Berkeley, as far as I understand, forgive me if I am asking a very naive question, but the spirit is still to consider higher education as a public good. Now, the fact that the institution itself is public, because there is a public funding, does not seem to help to, you know, to act publicly in the sense that you would in other words, my question is, if you go with this logic further, that there is a drop of the public support, do you think that at some point you can be you can go private and nevertheless act for the public good?
Yeah, it's a great question. And one of the questions I had in my interview that was after all the questions about student protest was, would you support detaching the university from the state, give the state a certain number of years to make up the state allocation and some kind of endowment fund? And I knew it was a trick question, so I didn't answer it. Had I answered it, I probably would have enraged half of the search committee, and so I wouldn't have had the great opportunity to go to Berkeley. But the question is more and more urgent, because I do believe right now that it's become increasingly difficult for us to actually serve the public mission as we want to do as an institution, right, in terms of culture. That's deep. That cultural commitment is pervasive across the university, with all the constraints that we have. Just to make concrete what this means, we were getting before the recession about $550 million a year. We're now getting about $350 million a year from the state. And although there hasn't been a lot of inflation, there's obviously been some. And it's been 10 years. So that kind of, the level of state funding is not going to come back. And increasingly, I mean, I raised in my last year $500 million. And one could imagine, in fact, over time, creating a major endowment, and we would be able to raise money more readily if people didn't feel that the state was going to take that money, treat it substitutionally, and withdrawing more state money from Berkeley to punish it, as it were, for raising too much money. So I think it's going to be an issue that's going to come back. Now, of course, the state doesn't want to let go, and so it would be a huge political kerfuffle and debate. But I think increasingly now, in the U.S. context at least, it's going to be a debate that needs to at least be conducted in a serious way by some of the thought leaders in government, in industry, and certainly in the university sector. One thing is clear, that we can no longer as a university, I think, just sort of assume that change should only be incremental. What I had hoped in the strategic planning process was not only to address the financial crisis, but actually to take on what it meant to be training students at a time when the jobs that they're often training for aren't going to exist in 5 years. And particularly in California, where the recognition of change around technology, of artificial intelligence, machine learning, automation and the like, is going to change so much of what we do. The need for departments like sociology and anthropology to collaborate with computer science and other departments that are at the mechanical and electrical engineering is greater than ever. And so I think the university is going to have to take on this change, and to do so, it's going to have to adjust some of its governance regimes. Now, that may be more of a genuine push factor for changing the way in which we think about privatization, mm-hmm. than a discussion around governance. Only at a meeting of Times Higher Education can you get a group of people in a on an afternoon after the rankings have been released to actually come and talk about governance. It's obviously of compelling interest on each of our own campuses, but it's not the sort of thing that, unlike vice chancellor's pay, makes headlines. But I think there will be indeed other kinds of things that will really force institutions, great institutions like Berkeley, to say, well, we're going to have to change and think about changing every part of our institution.